Hi guys, and happy new year. Hope everyone's year was a good one, and I hope this year's going to be an even better one. Today, I thought I'd kick off 2015 with a top five list, going back to films, because I'm done with vlogs for a long time. What I mean by contemporary is anything made from the year 2000 to present day. Why not celebrate Britishness? Because there's really nothing else in Britain that I like. Five films. These aren't in any particular order apart from number one, because it's my favourite film of all time. And the only other rule that I gave myself, aside from talk about contemporary British films, is I have to own the films to talk about them, because I don't like talking about films on camera when I don't have anything to show. So, yeah, with that all said and done, let's just get straight onto it. So the first film is Berberian Sound Studio, directed by Peter Strickland and starring Toby Jones in the lead role. Toby Jones plays as a sound engineer, and he goes to Italy to basically be put in charge of recording the Foley artists for editing the sound of an Italian horror film. Well, it's sort of like a horror slash giallo film, and you can definitely see the influence of giallo cinema in this film because there are a lot of visual nods. There's a great use of colour, especially high contrast reds. The sound engineering on the film is phenomenal. It's filled to the brim with atmosphere, and there's a lot of dread. Toby Jones basically plays as a guy who is descending into madness. What he's seeing on screen, he doesn't know if it's real or fake, and he's getting so sucked up into it. Now, a lot of people might say that this is purely style over substance. I would completely disagree. This does style, and it also nails down the substance perfectly. And being a fan of giallo cinema, it's got that angle for it. And the score from Broadcast is very unnerving in places. It suits the film perfectly, and the fact that I forgot what her name is, but the woman from Broadcast died shortly after this, it also just adds that little extra, and for me it's just an absolutely phenomenal piece of filmmaking. The second film is the first Ben Wheatley film that I'm going to be talking about in this list, and this is his latest film, A Field in England, which, again, going back to the style over substance argument, a lot of people rarely dislike Ben Wheatley's films. I could kind of see why. Some of his storylines go completely off the rails, but that's on purpose, and I like his style of storytelling. When he combines that with his fantastic directorial skills, you're in for such a treat. Now, this film is a complete headfuck. Filmed in black and white, literally filmed in a field in England, and released on multi-platforms all at the same time. You could watch it in the cinema, or you could watch it on Film 4, you could buy the DVD and Blu-ray, or watch it video on demand. And it just shows you that there is an audience out there for interesting cinema, and that's exactly what A Field in England is. It's got striking imagery, it's again got a beautiful score, which adds a whole level of tension to it. Combine that with some really psychedelic imagery, even though it's all shot in black and white. Great use of lo-fi film techniques. And what you have is just an utterly beautiful film that just goes to places you never thought it would do. This is probably the ultimate Marmite film, because you either love it or you hate it. And I absolutely adore it. And that is Kill List. I think, is it Nigel Maskell, and Michael Smiley play as two, like, ex-soldiers or something like that. They don't really go too much into detail about what they did, even though they refer back to it a lot. So there are a lot of questions there that sometimes don't get answered, but it adds to the film. And if you want a film with a completely batshit crazy ending, this is the one for you. It's got a pagan tone to it that I really enjoyed. I can see why people would hate this film, especially the final 10-15 minutes, but I just think it adds for such a wonderful experience. Questions that are asked that don't get answered, they stick in your mind, and you start to think, well, maybe this means that, maybe that means this. It just all culminates into a spectacular experience. Number two is a documentary about one of my idols, one of my heroes, Joe Strummer, and this is Joe Strummer, The Future is Unwritten, directed by Julian Temple. It's not just a, you know, music biography documentary sort of thing. It's accessible. You don't have to be a fan of The Clash or Joe Strummer to appreciate it. And what I like most is it doesn't just purely glorify Joe. It shows you that he had his dark sides. It shows you that he wasn't perfect. But it also shows you that deep down, Joe Strummer was just a pure heart of gold. And it's such a shame that he died just as I was getting into The Clash, because I would give anything to see Joe Strummer alive. And yeah, it is genuinely an emotional documentary, really well made. And yeah, it's just a beautiful film. Now, my favourite film of all time is also music related, and it's set at what I consider one of music's greatest eras. And that film is 24 Hour Party People, directed by Michael Winterbottom, another director who I've got a hell of a lot of time for. Star-studded, you've got Steve Coogan playing as Tony Wilson. He plays him brilliantly. Of course, there are some aspects that he rarely goes over the top in, I find, but yeah, it's just a great performance. The best performance for me, though, in this film is Paddy Considine. Now, he plays as Joy Division's manager, whose name escapes me right now. But when you see archival footage of the manager and look at Paddy Considine's performance, he nails it down to a T. And testament to Paddy Considine, one of my favourite acts of all time. Paddy Considine is brilliant in this. Everyone involved is brilliant in it. Even Peter Kay in his small role is great. Who else have we got in there? We've got Ralph Little, John Sim, Shirley Henson. Just a who's who of British cinema and TV at the time. They come together, do a great job. If you're a fan of Manchester and the cultural history of Manchester, and just a fan of culture in general, it's essential viewing. Plus, it's got a really lo-fi feel to it. It feels like it was made on a very small budget, but I like that about it. It's not glamorous. It's not the most beautifully shot film in the world, but it works for the film. And seeing Manchester on camera is always a good thing for me. I absolutely adore Manchester. I want to spend as much time as I can in Manchester. It's my favourite city. 24 Hour Party People. It's not for everyone, don't get me wrong. There are some people who will watch this and think this is boring shite. But to me, this is just arguably the greatest British film ever made. It's my favourite film of all time. And being a fan of bands like the Happy Mondays, Joy Division, The Smiths, even though they're not really mentioned in this, aside from a couple of jokes, the whole scene, the whole culture. And if you're a fan of punk rock, then there's obviously, it talks about when the Sex Pistols played in Manchester the first time and the influence that they had on the youth culture. And yeah, it's just a brilliant film. What can I say? So that's my list, guys. Honorable mentions, of course. I could have included This Is England, Dead Man's Shoes, 28 Days Later, one of the greatest British horror films of all time. The list is endless, but that's my list. That's my top 5 favourite contemporary British films. And if you want to do your own response, feel free to do so. So guys, thanks for watching. Hope your 2015 is going to be a good one, and I shall see you later.